This is Tatooine Sons, a proud member of the Star Wars Commonwealth Podcast Network. Be sure to listen to the galaxy's greatest Star Wars podcasts, including Talk Star Wars, Tumbling Sabers Podcast, Generation X-Wing, Rogue Squadron Podcast, Skyhoppers Podcast, The Nerd Room, San Diego Sabers Radio Podcast, and Less Than 12 Parsecs Podcast. Visit StarWarsCommonwealth.com and take your first step into a larger world.
Star Wars fans to episode 46 of Tatooine Sons. Variety magazine is reporting that JJ Abrams is being asked by Lucasfilm and Disney to fix Star Wars. Is everyone's favorite space fantasy saga in need of a course correction? We'll discuss that. Plus, we'll break down last week's episode of Star Wars Resistance, give a preview of tonight's episode, and we'll share our hot takes from this week's news. I've got a bad feeling about this. It's time for Tatooine Sons.
The Force is strong in my family.
I am your father.
I am a Jedi, like my father before me.
Welcome, Star Wars fans. This is Tatooine Sons, your weekly look into all things Star Wars. From the unique perspective of a father sharing his love for the amazing space fantasy saga with his two sons. I am BB Nate, and I'm joined first by my brother, Samuel the Hutt.
A Church of Star Wars fans, thanks for tuning in. And if you're not a Star Wars fan, then, you don't get to visit the Lucasfilm headquarters.
Yeah, that's true.
That is.
Yeah. Unless you're
That's right. I was going to say Indiana Jones. What other things have Lucasfilm done that would be like a big reason to go to the Lucasfilm headquarters?
I think that's about it.
Okay.
Well, I mean, they did all do the Skywalker sound, or Skywalker sound has all done.
Yeah, like, I know. Yeah, like that's true.
Every movie.
That's true, BB Nate.
Yeah.
Anyway.
And of course, you can have Star Wars without bizarre father figures. So on that note, here's my dad, the Bowtie Jedi guy.
What's up, dudes?
Hello.
What's up?
You guys ready for this week?
Yes, I am.
Anything good happening this week? I know we kind of teased it there, but tell the fans. Come on.
All right. Well, we're Wednesday. We're heading down to the Lucasfilm headquarters up in San Francisco, and we're gonna have our own private tour by Matt Martin of the Lucasfilm Story Group,
the gentleman in charge of the. Story group elements for the season 7 of the Clone Wars.
Right. Yeah. Nothing big.
So no. He just has some.
So we're gonna hang out. We're gonna do some San Francisco stuff. Mm-hmm. Over a couple of days. But let's just be really honest. The only reason we decided to go to San Francisco is because nobody really cares about the bridge. We don't care that much about the bridge.
It's kind of cool.
You know, it was like, okay, when are we doing the Lucasfilm tour? Okay, if we could fit in Alcatraz around that, we will. But we'll go down to the Fisherman's Wharf and we'll eat some bread and we'll go down Lombard Street, that really curvy street. Yeah. Maybe we'll find some monk.
Who decided that was a good idea?
I don't know, but that's a cool street. Went down on it. When Mom was pregnant with you, Sam, so this was like before we even thought you were ever going to exist, Nate. We went to San Francisco for your papa's birthday with me, my papa, Jody, your uncle, Chris, mm-hmm. your mom, obviously, me. And we rented a big limousine for your papa's birthday. And we had like a huge stretch limo. And we did this giant tour, picked them up at the airport. They didn't know we were going to be there. They were just thinking that your papa and your mima were going to there. And we picked them up at the airport in this big stretch limo, went on a tour. And we went down Lombard Street.
In a limo?
In a giant limo like that. That was,
how do you do that?
That was a lot of fun. So, yeah. Anyway.
That's cool.
Anyway.
So, yeah. We're super pumped. And if you're not familiar with who Matt Martin is, or if you've not heard of him, you might know Pablo Hidalgo. Right? He's pretty vocal on social media and, pretty famous. When everyone thinks of, Lucasfilm Story Group or, Star Wars canon, you think of Pablo Hidalgo. Not many people know Matt Martin is on the same level as Pablo Hidalgo in terms
of
authority.
Like the Lucasfilm Story Group,
right?
And stuff.
Yeah. And so he's just not as vocal on social media. So I mean, this is This is a pretty big deal.
He's really vocal on social media. I think it's just Pablo has been...
Pablo is a spokesperson.
Yeah, he's like he tends to be the spokesperson for the story group.
Okay.
He's the one that always goes on stage at Celebration with Filoni, and they talk about stuff. And Pablo was always in the Star Wars show episodes and stuff like that. So he's like the face of the story group. Yeah. But Matt Martin does the same type of stuff.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
It's pretty cool. We're really honored, and we're probably making this bigger in our head than it's going to be. But to be invited, you know, it's awesome.
So. Yeah, I mean, we automatically started like fantasizing, oh my gosh, what if they ask us to like be on the Star Wars show and they like canonize Turbis right there, you know, going on these like...
Yeah, well, if they do canonize Turbis... The
we might cry, right there.
We might have to go step into a bathroom and wipe.
Yeah, but like this is like the
bring segment. An extra change of pants,
right? Yeah, you know, this is the predictions sure to go wrong segment,
right.
But for real life, but you know, we're super excited and I can't wait. I've been telling all my friends, get this, we're going to Lucasfilm next week. You know. Like it's a big deal, and they're like, oh, that's
they're cool. Like, yay, that's cool. What's Lucasfilm?
Well, I mean, most of my friends though are Star Wars fans, so they get it. But you know, some of the other friends are like, oh, that's cool. Yeah. You know?
For us, it's like this is like the one thing we needed to do before we moved out of California. They got on the list,
literally,
right?
the last thing we had to do.
Exactly.
Nothing else. Not see the Golden Gate Bridge. No.
And we can afford it now. You see how that worked?
Beautiful segue.
Nice little segue. Yeah. We have. I'm going to have to switch over here to sound effects because this is like a really big deal. We're going to have to like really do a Turbis shout out. We have our first ever $100 a month Patreon supporter.
Woo!
That's
nuts.
That's amazing.
That's
absolutely
insane.
Off the charts. So I woke up this morning and I saw this email come through. I woke up at 4 a.m. because we had church stuff all morning and I had to get stuff done before that. And I opened up my email, you know, while I'm peeing.
Let's be honest.
Everybody brings their phone in there when they sit on the toilet.
But that's a little TMI for the podcast. You realize that's like immortalized forever.
Yeah, I know. I don't care. So anyway, I'm sitting there on my... And John Karst is our supporter we're talking about here. He's been a supporter of us from the very beginning. One of our earliest supporters. Before we even did Patreon, he was like a big fan on Twitter and supporting us and sharing our stuff.
Did he follow us on YouTube before we started the podcast?
I'm not sure if he did or not. He might have. But anyway, were just doing a YouTube video.
Those were the dark times.
Yeah.
I want to go home and rethink my life.
Yeah, we realized we're not a YouTube channel. Anyway, so I'm sitting there on the toilet and I'm opening up my emails and I see this $100 a month pledge from John, and I'm like, what in the world? Did he make a mistake? I literally wondered,
That's what I would think, too.
Impressive. Every word in that sentence was wrong.
Yeah, I thought maybe that, like, every word in the sentence on the email was wrong.
Just like waiting for him to say, oh, sorry, that was an accident, my bad.
Exactly. Like, oh, I meant $10. But then, a few minutes later, I was flipping through and I was checking notifications on Twitter and he like tagged us on a post. He's like, I cannot wait for you guys to wake up to this morning. You guys are so awesome. You're so positive. We want to support you guys and I want you to know how much I'm behind you. And so I'm like, dude, people don't do that for a $10 a month. Pledge. And so I'm like, dude, you blew us away. And so I told him that I was going to like try to steal something from Lucasfilm for him, and it was worth jail time.
Pretty much.
This is not going to go the way you think.
This is another thing I was telling all my friends about who know that we do a podcast. I was like, dude, we got $100 a month Patreon. They're like, oh, that's cool. I'm like, but that's $100 a month.
I know. That's insane. And let's just be honest. If John, if you're listening to this, which you are, because obviously anybody that would pledge $100 a month to support a podcast listens to the podcast.
Yeah, that's the same
thing. John, first of all, thank you. You're awesome.
Yeah.
Second, don't ever feel obligated to keep it at $100. If you need to drop it back, we totally get it. But we are really grateful for it. And then thirdly, I want to say this. Anybody that supports this podcast, and even if they don't support it financially on Patreon, if you support it through reviews, if you support it through tweeting us links out, following us on Twitter and interacting with us there, on Instagram, on Facebook, anything you do
just
to support
listening.
This podcast, we truly do appreciate it.
Absolutely.
But honestly, you know what? With the situation that we've been going through with the job change and moving and all that, finances are really tight. And so to have, you know, people that are supporting this podcast financially, from $1 to $100 and everywhere in between, every single dollar means the world to us, that you would actually take your money and help fund a silly little conversation once a week about a sci-fi movie or a space fantasy movie series, and be so engaged with what we do that you financially support it. It does two things. One, it makes us really humble to think that people would do that. But secondly, it makes us want to do the best podcast that we can do. And so, you know, it's not just fun for us that we do. It is fun for us, but it's more than that. We want to really put out a great product, and we're really talking about how to do that. So thank you so much. If you want to become a supporter of Tatooine Sons on Patreon, it's really simple. You can go to our website, Tatooine Sons, SONS.com. TatooineSons.com. You can go there and you can find all the information there, or you can go to Patreon, just search Tatooine Sons, or you can go Patreon.com/TatooineSons. So there's lots of different options. How's it going over there, BB Nate?
Going good.
Quiet? Had a long day yesterday.
Yes.
Had a long day today.
Yes.
I'm feeling a little bit down. Wait, what was under the weather.
What was yesterday?
Yesterday we had that thing at church for the Israel trip.
Oh, that's
right. The debrief, yeah. So.
I'm a little tired. We're all a little bit out of it.
I'm
sitting here and we're just in the intro of the podcast, and I noticed I'm like zoning out.
Yeah, we can't do that. So we're going to keep going because we've got people like John and Neil Lowry and Megan and the guys from the Star Wars Commonwealth podcast network and everybody else that are supporting this podcast. So thank you guys so much. And we will do a great podcast for you. And the other thing is, please, you know, good vibes. You know, prayers, whatever you want. As we go to Lucasfilm this week, all three of us are going to be wearing our hashtag Make Turbis Cannon t-shirts. We're going to be bringing thousands of stickers, and we're going to be handing them out to anybody. The janitor will have stickers on his mop bucket if we see him.
We're going to like go up to some ledge and just like throw them.
We're going to just like give out, you know, it'll be like making it rain with the stickers. You hear that? That's making it rain, right? Anyway, yeah. That was pretty good. So anyway, yeah. We're gonna go around and give those stickers out. It's gonna be obnoxious. They're gonna probably have security escort us out. Either we're gonna have Turbis made canon by the end of this, or we're gonna be escorted out. Actually, probably neither one of those two things will happen.
That's true.
We'll be respectful with that. But all right,
we're gonna try to be respectful while we're down there. But I think we're gonna all like be geeking out the whole time.
Yeah, geeking out is the right word. Like when Matt Martin says, okay, when you get here at such and such a time, first of all, just come in by the big Yoda fountain. And the first thing you're thinking of is, like, that's the Yoda fountain for the Star Wars show! Oh my God!
Right,
you know, and so we're like, we're going to come by the Yoda fountain! And then he's like, when you get to the front desk, just ask them, I'll have your names, I'll have you already registered, and then they'll call me and I'll come down and escort you through. I'm like, what?! They're going to have our names already!
We're going to be walking around seeing all this memorabilia, and it's going to be like an everyday.
You know, one of the things that I'm kind of hoping we get to do is, if you remember from the Star Wars show a couple of months ago when Andy Gutierrez had her birthday and Anthony Carboni filled her entire office with the pool balls.
Like the ball pit thing.
And then they like took them out and they put them in there. And they've actually created like a little ball pit there. I want to jump into the ball pit. I'm hoping we get a chance like to walk through that area and see the ball pit. I'm going to be like, hey, Matt, can we jump in real quick? And I'll be like totally going to be doing this right now.
Yeah, so. I mean like, it's going to be so much
It's going to be awesome. So, all right. Last thing before we kind of get into the show. Thank you guys for your ratings and reviews. Please, please, please do this. We're doing a changeover from Blog Talk Radio's platform to the Spreaker platform again. And when we did that, we lost a lot of we lost some downloads because of some of the changes. And we're working to get that repaired and fixed. But the thing that's going to help the most is if you're on iTunes, if you can go open up that app right now, give us a rating, give us a review. We'd really love to be able to get to 45 reviews or 45 ratings and 25 reviews by the end of this week. So. Please, please, please take time to do that. All right. So you guys ready to get into last week's podcast?
Yeah.
That was a good one.
Do it.
Are you brainless? I never ask that question until after I've done it. What? No!
All right. So last week was a great poll for us. We cleared over 1,000 votes on our podcast poll of the week. It was a really popular one. It was all about the Boba Fett. That's what we talked about last week.
Is that our most popular poll?
No, I think when we did the Raylo show. Raylo like took on a world of its own. I think it had like 2,000 votes on its poll, because like Raylo is like the hottest topic in Star Wars right Twitter
pretty much
right now. But anyway, here was the podcast poll from last week. Now that the Boba Fett film is off the table, what character are you most hoping to see in a Star Wars movie? We had four different options. We had we changed it up. It was going to be Darth Vader, but BB Nate made such a compelling argument for Ahsoka during our podcast last week that we put Ahsoka in there. Good thing we did. So we had Ahsoka, we had Maul, we had Kenobi, and then we had someone else with a comment below. So who do you think won? I know you guys are seeing the poll, so I guess it doesn't really matter. You're looking
Kenobi.
Kenobi won.
I thought Kenobi was going to win last week.
Yeah. So Kenobi won with 52%. Well, you know, over half the vote.
Yeah.
And when you have four different choices, that's like a pretty resounding victory. Please listen to us. I mean, we'll mention it at Lucasfilm. We'll say to you know, when Kathleen Kennedy's like visiting while we're there.
Oh yeah, yeah.
You know, and she invites us into her office to hear the story of Turbis before they make it canon.
Oh,
We'll have the conversation that you guys expect us to have with Kathleen. I'm going to call her Kathy.
We're on a not only a first name basis, a nickname basis.
So Kathy, the fans have spoken. They really want the Kenobi movie.
Impressive. Every word in that sentence was wrong.
Actually, I think I was more looking for this one.
This is not going to go the way you think.
Both of them will work, but those are good sound effects. But anyway, Kenobi won. Second place, BB Nate. Second place. High five. High five. Happy beeps.
Happy beeps.
Yeah, Ahsoka. 24% of the people voted for Ahsoka. Ahsoka's a popular one. So we'll mention that to Dave Filoni while we're up there.
He's going to make another Clone Wars animated movie, but it's just going to be all Ahsoka.
I don't know if they'll ever do a Clone Wars animated movie again. No. But if they do a live action movie, that would be pretty amazing. So of Ahsoka. 13% got Maul. So 13% kind of want to see what happens. Either I liked the idea of what happened, which we talked about last week, between the Clone Wars storylines and
Solo.
Yeah, I would love to see a Maul movie from how that
he rose
time
to power.
Absolutely,
for the
Crimson Dawn gets started. Maybe we can even see how Kira gets to be a part of Crimson Dawn, because that's a story we haven't heard answered yet. So that would be a cool storyline. And then 11% said someone else. And so we've got three different options. We got Tom Blythe. I think Tom is new to our show, at least as Twitter goes on it. At Freewheel Tweet had a really good idea. Tom Blythe said, "I would love an Enfys Nest film." I feel there's just so much they could do with such a cool character. What do you guys think about that? BB Nate, what do you think about the idea of an Enfys Nest film?
I really don't know what they could do with it. I can see how she got with the Rebellion and all, and I mean how she even came up with rebelling against Marauders and be working for Crimson Dawn, but I don't know if they would go with that.
I think there's two potential storylines, BB Nate. There's the storylines before Solo with Enfys Nest, or really what happens with Enfys Nest after she gets the Coaxium and this whole start, like her role in launching the Rebellion.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Personally speaking, that's the one I would want to see.
Yeah,
I don't care what happens before Solo with her. She's just a character that's like causing problems. But when she gets the Coaxium and she starts talking to Han about the Rebellion, that's what I would like to see. What do you think about that idea, Sam?
Yeah, I mean, I totally agree. Maybe we see her somewhere around the time of Rogue One and she interacts with Jyn or Cassian. But if you read the Solo novel, or even just the excerpts that they release online, you know that Enfys met young Jyn.
Haven't gotten to there yet.
Well, it was in the excerpt.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah.
But yeah, I mean, I want to see.
There's a Saga Rare connection and all that stuff.
Yeah, I mean, she is a cool character, and I think they could do a lot with her. I mean,
and now that I'm thinking about it, it would be cool to see Saga Rare's character being in another live action film. Get Forrest Whitaker to bring. He loves playing it. He did the Rebels episodes after Rogue One.
Yeah.
I mean, he's a big fan of this character. Let him come in and do Saga Rare with Enfys Nest, and that maybe we find out more of that storyline there. Yeah. I would love that. That would be a lot of fun.
Yeah, she's... Yeah.
Okay. Next one was from Corey Quihula. I think that's
probably how you spell it. Probably murdered her last name.
It could be a guy.
That's Corey. Yeah, that too.
Yeah. C-W-I-H-U-L-A. Corey Quihula. At Corey Quihula. I'm going to just let that one be. All right. Okay. I've absolutely got to see what happens when and after Kira goes to Dathomir to meet with Maul. So this is a Maul vote, I have a feeling. But it's more it's focused on Kira. Yeah, I think it feels a little bit more like Kira. What do you think about the idea of like them doing a standalone Star Wars story that's built an anthology film built off of Kira more than Maul? What do you think about that idea, Samuel?
I think it'd have to be a Kira after Solo. I mean, unless it's way before Solo too. I mean, it'd either have to be way before Solo, before Han and Kira even met, maybe, or after Solo, when Kira's meeting up with Maul. And that's the one I'd probably be more interested with, I mean, because that's been something we've all been trying to understand and figure out where that goes ever since the movie came out. Mm-hmm. You know, trying to understand what's going to happen with that. So, I mean, I think most people would prefer that story, too. Yeah, I mean, I just want to see what happens with those two characters. Okay. So,
what do you think about that idea, BB Nick?
I mean, they can do it, but I feel like they're going to just leave Solo as it is. Well, I mean, they kind of have to resolve the whatever happened after, but I think they're going to resolve that.
So what about Kira, though? Like, the idea of a standalone movie with Kira. Do you think that they can do that?
I mean, they can if they want to. I mean, they're Lucasfilm, but I just really don't think that they would.
I think if they did a Kira movie, I think that the best storyline for me would be we pick up after she's captured by Lady Proxima's goons on Corellia, leading to the whole storyline leading to the moment Han walks in. Where we find out how she goes from being captured in this like really bad situation to somehow becoming the right hand for Dryden Vos and one of the like chief leaders of Crimson Dawn, and all the storyline with that. And you can have this Maul sort of like cloud over the storyline without him actually being too much involved in it. You maybe even could insert him in a couple of times. It doesn't need to be a Maul movie. And then you get Paul Bettany. Bettany, I keep wanting to call him. Paul Bettany. Yeah, I know, I'm tired. Paul Bettany, he comes in and he can talk. You do the Dryden Vos character. I think that'd be a lot of fun to do. And it's got no Skywalkers. It's got no rebellion, really. It's got no Force stuff going on. It would be kind of along the vein of Rogue One.
Very similar, yeah.
With that, so cool. Mike G. Mike has been a big fan of ours, a supporter of ours for a long time. His name would be pronounced good-hearted, but it's spelt differently. And he is good-hearted. You're a good guy, Mike.
Happy babies.
So anyway, Mike good at good-hearted. Mike G. G-O-E-D-H-A-R-T-E-D. He put two words down. And when I read it, I was like, ooh. Young Dooku. What do you think about that? Have you never thought about them doing a origin story of Count Dooku? Because we got to remember Count Dooku's story. Count Dooku is the Padawan. Do you remember who he's the Padawan?
Yoda.
So that would be fun.
Yeah.
And then he's the master of Qui-Gon. No,
that's right, Qui-Gon.
Yeah. Qui-Gon Jinn.
Yeah.
So pulling him in that storyline and then showing his descent into the dark side, that would be a lot of fun.
That would be fun.
I feel like they, I feel like if they're going to go anywhere with the next anthology movie, it's definitely either going to be Kenobi or another prequel anthology. They've already done Rogue One and Solo, which were before four in between That's three. Fair. So if they're not going to do a Kenobi, I think it would either be Ahsoka or Dooku.
I like the idea of Dooku, but I feel like they should do it not the next anthology, because you would be venturing into an area that's unexplored as of now in canon before episode one.
Yeah.
We've like, not gone like there.
Decades before episode one.
Which that's not Old Republic era for any.
But it's the glory days of the Republic.
Right. And the Jedi. And that's a huge deal. And that's something we've never gone before. We've never gone there before. So while I absolutely love the idea of a young Dooku, and now that you brought it up, I totally
actually
want to
Mike
see
brought it up.
Mike. I mean, I was talking to Mike.
Okay, Mike, thanks for bringing that up. Yes, that was a great contribution.
Since he brought that up, I would love to see it, but I feel like it has to be after we've started slowly inching our way into the before Episode One era.
And there would be no Skywalkers.
Yeah, that's true.
No Anakin, no. Yeah.
Well,
I mean,
would Shmi?
Yeah, but I don't think we're gonna have Shmi.
No, I don't think you go there, but she would.
She would be alive, most likely, at some point in the storyline. But very nice.
Interesting.
I appreciate that. Can I just say that as we were sitting here, you know, we're tired and we're stressed and we're dealing with moving and everything else. But as we got into this podcast, I was just sitting here. We were talking about this Count Dooku thing, and I thought, I really enjoy doing this with you guys every week. And every time I do this, like, I dread it on the front end. You know, like the prep and the notes and like getting started. Once we get started, I absolutely love that we do this every week. So I just wanted to say that. So,
all right.
That was cool. So I don't have any sound effect that fit that, but I'll do a turbis for it. So can we do that?
It works.
All right. Why don't we do it? I want you to go to Star Wars Resistance. We'll do a little recap of last week's and talk a little bit about last week's episode. And then we'll jump into playing that secret clip that they release, or that small little clip that they release every week for the new episode. We'll play that and see if... Have you seen it, Sam? Nate, mm-hmm. I know you watched it, mm-hmm. right? So you've seen the visuals.
Okay.
None of us have. I haven't seen it. I haven't paid any attention to it. I just recorded it.
I mean, no. I may have watched a little of it.
All right. So we'll talk about that episode, which we'll watch here a little bit later tonight, I think. Hopefully. And before we do that, let's be really clear. If you have not watched episode five of Star Wars Resistance, The High Tower, we are venturing into some serious spoiler territory. So I would advise you cut away for about 10 minutes and then come back or fast forward to 10 minutes. And we'll
or just watch the episode, pause it here and then.
Yeah, you can pause this podcast right now, go watch the episode, and then give us your immediate reaction on Twitter while you listen to our reaction for it, because it's been a week since we've seen it. Let's read the recap of The High Tower. Captain Doza's fuel rationing forces. Can I do this in like my radio announcer voice?
Yeah.
Okay, can I do that? Captain Doza's fuel rationing forces. I got to start over.
Do it again.
It's live.
It's okay.
All right. Captain Doza's fuel rationing forces Kaz and the rest of Yeager's team down to Aunt Z's cafe, where Kaz meets Hype Faison. Hype reveals that the First Order is bringing fuel to Colossus, and Kaz runs outside to watch the First Order's ship as it comes in. Hype then invites Tam, Kaz, and BB-8 to visit the High Tower, and Kaz excitedly agrees, hoping to find out what the First Order is doing on the platform. Using a comlink, he is able to listen in to Major Vonreg's meeting with Doza and discovers the First Order is offering protection from the pirates in exchange for control of the station. However, as he leaves, Vonreg discovers Kaz's actions. After a daring chase and an encounter with Doza and his daughter, bad punctuation.
Yeah, on you're supposed to.
Was this Wikipedia or this is Wikipedia? I should have gone to Wikipedia.
Boom.
Yeah, I need to.
Even I know you're supposed to.
I want to go home and rethink my life.
Totally went to the wrong one for that. Sorry about that, guys. Let's go back to that sentence. After a daring chase and an encounter with Doza and his daughter Tora, Kaz eventually ends up back at Yeager's shop, but not before Doza begins to suspect him as the spy. Now, we watched that episode last Sunday after the podcast, and both of you immediately said that it was one of your favorite episodes so far.
Mm-hmm.
Star Wars Resistance. Explain BB-8.
I'm in trouble there.
I'm tired. BB Nate, go. Tell us why.
It was just good.
Okay.
All right.
Yeah.
Beautiful. Right, that is amazing podcast content.
It had a lot of story and plot and development in it. Tam and Hype's friendship. And then how it broken apart and Niku being Niku during the whole episode.
You guys really love Niku.
Niku was hilarious this episode. Like, more so than usual.
And just everything about it. And the First Order, we got to see a little bit more of that. And so
Major Vonreg.
Mm-hmm. So. Yeah, I mean, I like this episode a lot. I would like to see more flying, because we only got like the first episode where they were actually flying ships, and it's basically that's been it. I mean, we got like 12 seconds while they were escorting in the ship this episode where they were flying, but that was about it. So I'd like to see more flying, but that aside, it was a really good episode. A lot more plot development, I think, especially on the lines of Kaz's mission. Yeah, and Niku was hilarious this time. I mean, he just keeps getting better and better. What was I going to say? Go ahead, Nate.
And just to touch on, earlier this week, I did look up the Rotten Tomatoes reviews.
Oh my gosh.
And they are just the most hilarious things I've ever seen.
If you want to laugh, go to Rotten Tomatoes and read the reviews that people are putting up there.
Two pages were full of 5 stars, and then the rest of the 72 pages were full of like 5 stars or 1.5 stars or half stars or something like that. And they're all like, what are these fake 5-star bots doing here?
Yeah, they were pretty funny. You know, I did. There's a couple things that happened in the episode that we should probably talk about. There was the banner of some sort in is it Torah?
Yeah,
in Torah's room. So Kaz goes. He's in the high tower. He's trying to get away from Major Von Reg and the First Order, and he goes into Torah's room, which it was a hilarious scene in the first place because Torah thinks that he's got like a crush on her, and he's like, dude, totally, that's not what's happening here. With it, which I thought that was funny.
Yeah.
From both perspectives, because I think it's her like with this like overconfidence, like oh, surely he's got this crush on me, and then him being like, whatever, I'm actually a spy. And in his mind,
he's thinking, I'm a spy
from the Republic or from the Resistance.
He's thinking she knows that he's a spy,
right? And there's this confrontation, but there's this banner on the wall. Mm-hmm. Explain Samuel the Hutt what that banner. Seems to be.
Yeah, I mean, I noticed it the first time we were watching through. It's the Phoenix Squadron symbol, not like the normal Rebel crest, but like Sabine's version, like her early version of
from like the first couple seasons of Rebels.
Like, and people, I mean, I even looked at something called the Buckets List, and they're releasing Easter eggs from each episode.
Oh, that's cool.
Oh, I need to watch that.
And it's not a video, it's on the Star Wars, an article.
Oh, okay.
And they have a video for it, but it doesn't touch into it as much as the article does. And they did say they didn't say that it was the Phoenix Squadron from Rebels. They did say it looked like it, but they did say that it was Sabine's art, in specific. Not just the Phoenix, but Sabine's.
So they made it clear that's Sabine's art that she has hanging on her wall.
It could be a reproduction. A
Yeah.
You do know that there's a theory out there that Kaz is the son of... of Ezra and Sabine.
I thought it was Tora. That was daughter.
No. That Tora's Doza.
We already know who her father is.
Yeah.
Whoa,
that wouldn't be possible.
There's a theory that Kaz is actually the son of Sabine and Ezra.
You know, I could actually see that.
And it kind of
because we see him talking to his dad.
But we don't see...
but we don't know who his dad is.
Yeah, but the voice is way off.
Okay.
The voice is low.
We don't need to argue about that. But it's a side note. Anyway. I was a little disappointed in this episode because my favorite it was fine. My favorite character, the one that I've been waiting to hear more about since we watched all those episodes at the very beginning when they first showed up on the Disney Now app, is Yeager. And they left us with these cliffhangers about Yeager's past, and then I didn't get those.
I really wanted some Yeager. I really feel like they're going to touch into that a lot in this next episode.
In the one that's coming out tonight?
And after the preview, I will tell you exactly why I think that.
Well, on that note, why don't we go... high five on the segue there, buddy. You're getting like you're a professional or something. All right, so let's go ahead and jump into this week's preview segment for episode 6, which is entitled, I've got it here, The Children... from, I don't know how to pronounce it.
Tahar,
or whatever.
Children. The Children from Tahar. Here's the preview.
20,000 credits?
Some reward for a couple of runaway brats. I'd love to score that bounty.
They're probably on the other side of the galaxy by now.
To most people, this water ball is the other side of the galaxy.
Give me another jet juice, NC.
That symbol. Have you ever seen it before?
I have not.
If I could find those kids, that reward would change everything.
But, Kaz, you are not a bounty hunter. I have seen bounty hunters, and you are definitely not one of them.
For that kind of money, I am. It's a win-win situation, Niku. I make a ton of credits, get Tam's part fixed, and help these kids. What could go wrong?
Whoa. So there's a $20,000 credit bounty for these two kids. Mm-hmm. And Kaz wants to go try to get the bounty. What is the symbol that they're talking about?
Do you recognize it?
No, I don't. Okay. I don't recognize the symbol itself. Okay. The symbol's new, very new.
Okay. Interesting. So, you know, what do you think? So explain. You said you had these ideas, BB Nate. So this is your chance. Go for it. Okay.
So why I think that Yeager's going to be a lot in this episode is
which that, I would be thrilled with.
Yes, that you would be thrilled with. The symbol, I mean, it looks like it could kind of be like a rebel or resistance kind of symbol that is put onto these two kids. And I'm thinking that from the picture that they show of the kids, that it may be Jaeger's kids.
You think they introduced that in this early in the series?
I really do, because doesn't he have two kids, Jaeger?
He does in the photo that we saw from Black Spire.
Is one a girl and one a boy?
I'm pretty sure. I have to go back and look.
In the picture, there's a boy and a girl.
Yeah, in the hologram.
And they seem the perfect age. Since the symbol, I'm thinking that that's either the alphabet squadron that Jaeger might be in, or the squadron that Jaeger was in.
Looking for the picture. Here it is. Found the picture. Kids? Let's see. I think it's only got one. BB Nate.
Uh-oh.
Looks like it's only got one little kid. But what I've seen in the picture of the kid, it matches the hologram that I saw.
Right? Yeah.
So, I mean, it's a possibility. We'll have to watch tonight.
We will.
And see what we think about that. Any predictions? So we're gonna. You think we're gonna have some Jaeger?
I think so. I think it's gonna be a Jaeger heavy episode.
I hope it's so. All right. What about you, Sam?
I think this is gonna be an episode to. Well, this may include Jaeger, but I think this is gonna be more of an episode building up the resistance side of the story. Now, I just get that vibe from the kids.
So they've introduced the characters. Then they at the end of the last episode, in episode 5, you have Captain Doza beginning to suspect that Kaz is more than what meets the eye. So we've established that Jaeger has got a backstory. Doza's now considering that there's a backstory. We've got the First Order actually being connected to the Hightower and the things going on in the Colossus. We've sort of got all the chess pieces on the board now. Mm-hmm. It's time to start moving those pieces around and starting to see things going on. I'm hoping that we see that tonight. So
cool.
That'll be awesome. All right. Very, very cool. All right. So let's move on to the next section of the podcast. Could we be getting the next major Star Wars video game within the next year? Jedi Fallen Order could be coming very soon. And remember, and this is a big one, guys. Remember how Kylo Ren had Darth Vader's helmet in The Force Awakens? Remember that?
Yeah.
It may be playing a huge role in Episode 9.
Hmm.
And someone very interesting dressed up as Princess Leia for Halloween. It's time for Hot Takes.
This is where the fun begins.
Well, you want the bad news or the really bad news?
Impressive. Every word in that sentence was wrong.
I was just singing that whole song right there.
Like, I was kind of hoping we were.
That's the General Grievous theme. Yep.
Yeah.
Dun, 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 dun.
You're just going to do it anyway.
I could do it, yeah. I love that theme, man. Dun, 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 dun. Sorry. Okay.
Oh, by the way, side note, General Grievous has been added to Battlefront 2.
Yeah, I heard it's been pretty cool. It's people are pretty excited about it. So
anyway.
That's not on my radar right now. Battlefront 2 isn't the video game. But another video game is part of our hot takes. So
segue.
All right. EA Star Wars Jedi Fallen Order may release in late 2019. From ScreenRant.com, EA's Star Wars game with developer Respawn.
EA again?
Mm-hmm. EA's Star Wars game with developer Respawn Entertainment, called Star Wars Jedi Fallen Order, might have a tentative release date of late 2019. Wow. The Star Wars license has been through a troubled history with EA since the publisher obtained the IP from the now defunct LucasArts. Not Lucasfilm.
Yeah, LucasArts.
Yeah. The promising and exciting single-player game, Star Wars 1313, was canceled before the acquisition. 2015's Star Wars Battlefront was poorly received for lack of content, and Star Wars Battlefront 2 received an even harsher backlash for a microtransaction controversy. Yeah. It was kind of ugly.
Big problem.
So I'm going to let BB Nate go first on this one. Is this good news on the Star Wars gaming front?
Well, I mean, I'm excited for the game and all, but
a single-player game.
Mm.
Playing as a Padawan.
It's going to be very... I feel like it's going to be very reminiscent of Force Unleashed.
So, you excited?
Yeah, I agree with Sammy. I really think it's going to be Force Unleashed. But I wish it would just come earlier. I mean, they've been working on this game for a while now, from at least the announcements that we've gotten. So I feel like that they should be almost done with it, unless it's like the most beautiful game that's ever been released, and also the best story in a game and voice actors. I don't know what they could do with this game. We don't have information on it. But
yeah, we really don't know anything about the plot.
I was going to say the exact opposite. I felt like we just recently learned about this game not a couple months ago.
Early summer, I think.
Yeah, and it's being released next year. I feel like that's really early.
Well,
and we don't know how long they've been working on it. Most games, I think the new Spider-Man game, that game is amazing, it's beautiful. They worked on that game for 3, 4, 5 years.
4 years.
4 years. I mean, that's a long time, and it worked out beautifully. It's an amazing game. I don't want them to rush on this game just to release it to kind of save face for Battlefront 2. I want them to take their time, put out a high-quality game with an amazing story, good graphics. I'm not even saying it has to be open world like Spider-Man. It can be just like, you know, Force Unleashed, a linear play, a linear style. But I just want it to I want them to take their time, put out a quality game to kind of help a retcon from the backlash for Battlefront 2.
Do you think that the reason that they're holding this game back, you know, Nate, you're concerned that they've been taking too long to release this game. Sam, you're willing to let them take as long as they need in order for them to do it right.
Right.
I think that the balance, you know, Star Wars should be about balance. At least The Last Jedi taught us that there's a lot of balance in the Force.
Oh, but they should remake that.
We're not talking about that today. Well, actually, we are talking about that later. But anyway, the point I'm making is, do you think that they're holding the story back until late 2019 because of something to do with other content that's being released?
Well, we're talking about Padawans, and we're talking about pre-Revenge of the Sith. We're talking about prequels here.
No, I think it's post-Revenge of the Sith.
It's after. You're a Padawan after the events of Order 66.
Yeah, that's what they said. So it's after Order 66.
Is it like right after or a couple of months?
I mean, so much so that I thought you could be Ahsoka or you could be Caleb Dune in this. I mean, it could be one of those characters.
I mean, they may release I really don't know where it could go with that. I mean, with that, I feel like you can go.
If Ahsoka's in the storyline, I don't believe that the character is going to be the main character for it. But if she interacts in the storyline, in some way, shape, or form, with it, I feel like there could be some connections to Episode 9. I just feel like there's a possibility that something is coming with Ahsoka in Episode 9. I'm not seeing any spoilers. I refuse to watch Mike Zero. I'm not reading express.co.uk. I don't watch read any of that stuff. But what I just got this gut feeling that something with Ahsoka could be coming with Episode 9. And if that's the case, then maybe we learn more about connections that tie into Episode 9 from this game. With it, which would be a fun way for them to do it. If there's a good single player storyline with it. So
yeah, I mean, I don't think that it's gonna. I don't think that they're waiting to release it due to new canon or anything that should be coming out, because I mean that area has been relatively well explored. So I don't think that it's gonna interfere with anything. I don't know what else they release. I just don't get that vibe. I mean, if there is Ahsoka in there, it's just like a side character or something. I don't know if it'll have something to do with Episode 9, but I mean, unless it's coming out, is it coming out before or after?
We don't know. Just late 2019.
So I feel like would really determine.
Yeah, absolutely. All right, next topic. Latest Darth Vader comic shows how Vader could return in Episode 9. So the latest issue of this is a spoiler. We're going to go like straight into, if you're a comic book guy, this is a spoiler, but we got to talk about this. Give us like 5 minutes
just
here.
Go, like,
no, he's good. I think he needs to hear this. So. Nah. The latest issue of the Darth Vader comic reveals that the Sith can survive as Force ghosts.
Well, yeah, we saw that from Darth Bane.
After death. Now explain.
You don't remember that in the Yoda arc?
You got some splaining to
do.
Do
you remember the Yoda arc?
You don't remember the Yoda arc?
I remember the Yoda arc somewhat.
It
went to Darth Bane's grave.
Well, yeah, but I figured what planet it was on. Was it? So it's with an M, I think.
Okay, it doesn't matter. Anyway, just tell me the story.
The Sith homeworld. He went down there. He went and he came across Darth Bane's grave, and Darth Bane came out as a Sith Force ghost.
That's interesting.
It was like, he was like fire, and it was all
weird. Was cool looking. But
here's how it ties in, though, okay?
Okay.
So, Palpatine, in this comic book, tells Vader that Lord Momin, we talked about him before.
That was Momin.
Momin, I don't know. Whatever. Yeah. Who had died long before this, had told Palpatine his story after his death. But here's where it gets interesting, because apparently his evil essence was contained within... Wait for it.
Oh, no.
His helmet.
I felt a great disturbance in the Force.
Sound familiar? What do you think about that, BB Nate? Mm.
So, can I say something real quick?
No, BB Nate.
Well, I think that really... why are they releasing this? If they're not going to use something for episode 9. Whole grandfather thing, talking to the helmet.
Yeah.
And all of the... They're releasing it with the comics. I mean, I don't know why they wouldn't release it in like a trailer or something. Because comics aren't really well
known. Could you imagine if we're sitting there at Celebration in April and they do the trailer and you see Hayden Christensen or you see Darth Vader as a Force ghost in that. What that would be like.
The whole place would just like...
I think we'd cry.
Freak out. It's different than Darth Vader and Rogue One. In that trailer. It's because you know Vader's alive in that scene.
Well, the problem is we see Darth Anakin Skywalker go back to the light side.
I was going to say something about this. First off, that doesn't surprise me that he was contained within the helmet. Darth Bane was only able to present himself near his grave. He was confined to that one area.
So he's confined in some type of an artifact. Absolutely. Or
something. And that's
like
not
that.
Uncommon for Sith things. I feel like Asajj was maybe in that Sith holocron you see in Rebels, because that was her voice, without a doubt.
Yeah.
So that may have been Asajj.
Wow. I'm freaking out a little bit right now.
But what if Vader's helmet has something to do with turning Kylo back to the light side?
Yeah, I wonder, I want to go back and watch Force Awakens now, because of that whole scene. Go, BB Nate.
With the whole Vader thing, I think that... Anakin Skywalker, I think he touches into both sides. And if he does come into the form as Darth Vader, I think it will be Darth Vader himself speaking. But I think he'll be...
So do you think that there's like a split personality?
I was going to say, maybe we see this scene where Kylo is in a room and he's talking to Vader on one side of the room. And
so it's like the devil and the angel, the demon and the angel.
And they're pulling him to the light or the dark.
I was thinking...
Wouldn't that be the coolest thing ever?
I was thinking... that it was only going to be Vader talking to him. But I was thinking that it's going to be Vader, like, the dark side wasn't the way to go. Mm. And trying to turn him away from the dark side, just Vader himself. Mm. Because Kylo doesn't look as Anakin Skywalker to be his grandfather. He looks as Vader to be his grandfather.
But I don't know. I mean, I obviously, of course, I like my idea better. But I can see where you're going with that. Vader showing, hey, it didn't really turn out that well for me.
I died and I didn't get any benefit from it.
I almost killed my son.
So now I've got all these Reylo ideas coming into my head, Lord. Where they're like replaying the idea of Padme with dying, and Kylo starts having visions of Rey dying, and he's like thinking of trying to connect with that power, and Vader shows up, or Anakin shows up, and tries to tell him that that's not the path.
I really want to see this intense scene where he's talking to Vader on one side, and Anakin,
and
they're pulling him, and he's like frustrated, and he doesn't know where to go, and they yell at him, and it's just this insane...
That's not how the Force works.
I don't know.
What was that date?
What if we see a Force ghost light scene?
Or some sort of like...
What if you have like like Anakin as like Darth Vader, like the Darth Vader version of Anakin?
And
then Luke as a Force ghost on the other side, and this confrontation between these three generations of Skywalkers.
Jeez,
it'd be kind of cool. And here's the thing, guys. Please, if you're listening to this podcast, this is all headcanon. We're not spoiling really anything here, because we are staying as far away from real spoilers as possible, and we won't share them because we don't want to even know them. With no, that, we because we, I ruined Rogue One for myself.
Oh, I remember that.
Oh, you not Rogue One, The Force Awakens. The Force Awakens. I ruined it. I knew the entire story before I walked in the order of the story. I can remember sitting at a lodge in Breckenridge when we went up there for a weekend.
Oh, I remember that.
Reading this and being like, that can't be true. And then sitting there in the movie theater and I'm like, oh, crap. Everything in this is true.
It takes everything away from
it. It does. So I didn't do that with Rogue One. And I didn't do that with Last Jedi. And they were awesome. So we're not...
And I've had... it's not Star Wars related, but I had the endings of the Spider-Man game spoiled for me.
That's so fun.
In the spot that it was supposed to be no spoilers for the game... And then an accidental spoiler. And I just find that to be so wrong.
So we're really being careful about that. So all of this that we're talking about, if it patterns anything you've read on other websites that are not spoilers protected and things like that. Anyway, please understand, we didn't read those on there. We're just coming up with ideas. Yeah. And it's probable that if you did read it on any other sites, it's other people just coming up with ideas too. So
it's other people stealing our ideas.
Yeah, it could be now in advance, right before you even have the ideas. That's weird. Next topic, because we haven't even finished hot topics, and we've got our main topic to go. So the Stranger Things cast dressed up as Star Wars characters for Halloween. And people have been saying for years that Millie Bobby Brown, who plays 11 in Stranger Things, looks eerily similar to a young Carrie Fisher. Mm. And now she dressed up in the classic Princess Leia costume from A New Hope. Do you think they'll ever make a Princess Leia origin movie starring the young actress Samuel Hutt?
I don't think so. But I think that she really wants it. And that's why she's dressing up like that. And the cast is doing it. And it's not unlike how we're doing the whole Turbis thing.
Exactly. Right?
We want it to happen
so bad. We're going to will it to become true.
But it's probably not going
to
happen.
I really think that they need to do a Princess Leia movie. We've gotten so much Skywalkers, and I know that Leia is a Skywalker, but we don't have her story from before the Skywalkers.
We want to see Leia Organa.
We want to see Leia Organa and Alderaan and how she gets into the Senate. And
well, I think the challenge with that, guys, is that
too much.
They explored that storyline to some extent in the Leia Princess of Alderaan novel with Holdo as a young and Leia and that's her first love and all this. I know that breaks your heart, Nate, because you really wanted Leia and Han's first love to be each other, but she was in love with some other guy and all this other stuff. It was a great book, by the way. If you haven't read that book, which, guys, you should read it too. I mean, seriously, it's great. Leia Princess of Alderaan is a great story. Thanks, Claudia Gray.
Problem is like, the movie would be too boring because it's all about politics.
Yeah. They could do it.
What, put Vader in there?
Who knows? Yeah, I'd be curious to see. All right. Let's move on to the main topic. Lots of longtime Star Wars fans were leery when Disney acquired Lucasfilm 6 years ago.
Yeah.
And for many of those fans, The Force Awakens didn't make things better. But it seems that The Last Jedi was the straw that broke the camel's back. Now Variety magazine is reporting that JJ Abrams is being asked to help get Star Wars back on track. We'll talk about that next.
Rebellions are built on hope.
If you live long enough, you see the same eyes in different people.
I find your lack of faith disturbing.
Since Disney purchased the rights, this is actually from an article from Screen Rant, where Screen Rant was talking about the Variety article. I know that there's like all these connections here. It's almost like a Star Wars movie, all these little different connections. Mm. But anyway, since Disney purchased the right to George Lucas' Star Wars franchise, there's been a ton of new and exciting content brought to the masses. I would agree with that. Mm-hmm. This includes both main installments and standalone films, which helped to expand the galaxy far, far away. And while the House of Mouse, that's what they call Disney, right? has made a ton of money with the franchise and already recouped the $4.05 billion investment made to acquire Lucasfilm. there have been some missteps of late. At least that's what the common consensus is. Mm. I would disagree. But anyway, the last two Star Wars releases were Rian Johnson's The Last Jedi, which continued the main narrative of the Skywalker saga, and Solo: A Star Wars Story. The latter was the second standalone film of the franchise, explaining the backstory behind characters like Han Solo, Lando Calrissian, and Chewbacca. But Solo was a box office disappointment. And The Last Jedi is arguably the most divisive film in the entire film franchise. And I would agree with that. So. But J.J. Abrams is reportedly hoping to change this narrative, put the franchise back on a better course. Abrams is continuing to make massive deals, and a new report by Variety alleges that he's been tasked with putting the ultra-popular space opera back on track. There are no details as to how this might come about, but it should be fascinating to see how the galaxy far, far away continues to grow and change. Does Star Wars Samuel the Hutt need a course correction?
I felt a great disturbance in the Force.
I as soon as I heard that JJ was tasked with putting Star Wars on the right course, it just immediately didn't sit right with me. It seemed like this article was written by one of those 20% fans.
Yeah, so if you don't understand what we're talking about with that, so since we started this podcast in beginning of December before The Last Jedi came out, mm-hmm. and have been fully engaging in the Star Wars social media fray, since that entire time, we have learned that there's probably about 80% of people that enjoyed movies like The Last Jedi and all those types of things, mm-hmm. and that a really, really, really vocal and they have every right to be upset. True. If they don't like the movie, but really, really vocal 20%.
Correct.
And they make things sound bigger than they are, mm-hmm. When it comes to that. So that's what we were talking about. Yeah. He's mentioning
this. So as soon as I heard that headline, it seemed like this was written by someone from the 20%, because they're immediately assuming that something's wrong with Star Wars. I don't think Lucasfilm thinks something's wrong with Star Wars. No, I don't.
The argument would be, they've come out. Bob Iger, CEO, or whatever of Disney, mm-hmm. has made it clear that they're going to be kind of walking back and slowing down the releases of some of the things. Solo: A Star Wars Story did not hit the numbers that were expected. Whether or not they did, it was great, and it was a fantastic movie, which it was.
Yeah.
And all those things doesn't really matter. What matters is it didn't do as well in the box office that was expected to do. So, and then The Last Jedi, it created some controversy. So I think that's where they're coming from on that. What do you think about this whole idea of BB-8?
I really don't think they have to correct anything with Star Wars. I think that Lucasfilm and Disney did say that the movie was okay. And they said, then they let the movie go into theaters.
Last Jedi?
Yeah, Last Jedi. Yeah. They let it go into theaters, of all things. And then if they didn't like it, they would have postponed it and made it again or make some changes.
Yeah.
And they felt fine with it. And some people didn't like it. And maybe Variety Magazine is some Russian bots.
Yeah, no. Variety Magazine, let's be real. I get where you're coming from on that, BB-8. But the reality is Variety Magazine is the source that Disney and Lucasfilm go to release information.
Very true.
And so if this is being released by Variety, it tells me that they heard this from somebody close. This is the Anthony Bresnikan level stuff. He's the one that always gets the exclusive photos of the Star Wars movies, mm-hmm. gets the interviews of the casts. This is the kind of stuff. I'm not sure Anthony Bresnikan wrote the article, but what I'm saying is Variety did. Mm-hmm. And he works for Variety, and they're not jeopardizing the cash cow that Star Wars is to them when it comes to the release of the new magazines and all that kind of stuff. The stories that scoops that they get, they're not going to jeopardize that by putting something out there that hasn't been confirmed. So I think that we've got a conversation that's going on within Disney and Lucasfilm, mm-hmm. saying that JJ, get this thing back on track, and it's been off track. What do you think about that idea?
I don't think, now this is kind of, I'm like destroying my own argument here, but it's not unlike Lucasfilm to want to fix films. I mean, they did it with Solo. They fired the directors right in the middle of production and hired a new guy and said reshoot most of the whole film. Mm-hmm. So it's not unlike Lucasfilm to do that. It's just the fact that, do they think that Star Wars needs to be fixed? I don't think that story-wise it needs to be fixed. I think the story so far is amazing. They may be a little worried about the box office sake because Solo, to them, was not... It didn't perform the way it should have, and they need Episode 9 to perform that way. Now, I don't think Episode 9 is going to have a problem. It's the last episode in the Skywalker saga, and it's had enough time to breathe since Solo, I think, that most of the stuff will have calmed down.
It'll have been 2 years from the release of The Last Jedi. So the last saga movie would have been released two years earlier, and a year and a half since the last Star Wars movie. Right.
So I don't think that there's going to be a problem. I just think they want JJ to make it to have an emotionally resonant ending to resonate with the fans, kind of simmer everything back down, not make the fan base, kind of help connect the fan base back together again after it's been really polarized lately. I think that's what they want. I don't think they're wanting it, because it could be misinterpreted as they want him to fix the story. I don't think anything's wrong with the story, and I don't think they think something's wrong with the story. I think they just want to fix the fan base and the box office take.
BB Nate, do you think that Disney and Lucasfilm are concerned with the story of the Skywalker saga as it is right now, and they want J.J. Abrams to fix the story?
Not at all. I think that they're fine with the story right now. The whole how everything ended with Luke Skywalker dying, and then Rey and Kylo kind of going their separate ways. Rey's full light, Kylo's full dark, and then I think they're gonna... Eight was the very breaking point movie, and nobody... I mean, I don't think they're expecting people... I think they're expecting people to like it. I think they're expecting some people not to like it, like in every movie that ever comes out.
And you have to remember, Empire Strikes Back was a very polarizing film when it came out as well, so...
And so I think their Episode 9, they just tried to leave it on a very bad note, kind of. And I think in Episode 9, they're going to try to resolve everything in the whole Skywalker saga to make it into something that all the fans would hopefully like. Mm-hmm. And always, like I said, there are going to be some hecklers and people that did not like the movie. In every movie that comes out, there's those type of people. So... That's what I think.
Yeah, and I don't, like you were saying, do you think they need to fix the film? I don't think they
would fix the story. Star Wars.
I don't think they would have released The Last Jedi. I think you've touched on this. Release The Last Jedi if they didn't like it. I don't think they would be letting Rian Johnson create a whole series of movies if they didn't like it. Especially, I mean, and he's still on that.
Oh yeah, after he confirmed it very, very clearly.
Right. After all the backlash, yep. Lucasfilm has not fired him. I don't think they have a problem with the story or Rian Johnson or The Last Jedi or anything. So,
well, the reality is they were not prepared for the reaction that came from The Last Jedi. I think that they were anticipating the same type of reaction that the three of us had and a lot of the people that are sort of on that 80% side that we talk about, which was this was completely the opposite of the way we thought everything was going to go in this film. And they actually teased the fans. Like, the whole Reylo thing goes halfway through the movie. You're like, oh my gosh, they're actually going to do this Reylo thing in this movie. And we've got all this going on. And then they pulled the rug out from underneath all of us. In this movie, and there
and
was
they killed off Luke,
and they but you kind of wondered if that was going to happen, but you know, when they said that they weren't going to kill off Leia in the movie, then I was concerned that they might kill off Luke, but the reality was everything took a hard right turn that nobody expected, and a lot of people really liked that. But then there's this group that hated it and absolutely just... I mean, we know some of those people. We've got friends that are some of those people that they love, like Daniel from church. Mm-hmm. He's a longtime Star Wars fan. Oh, yeah. Went with his brothers to the 77 original Star Wars in the theaters showing and loved it and was super looking forward to The Last Jedi and just absolutely hates this movie, and loves Solo. He went and saw Solo and absolutely loved Solo, A Star Wars Story. So I think we've got two different problems, okay? We've got a financial problem with Solo, A Star Wars Story, and they have to make sure that they do not have that happen again, because the narrative around Solo stopped being about how great that movie is, and it is. It is phenomenal. The narrative became, it was a box office failure, and Lucasfilm and Disney don't want that narrative. On the other side, The Last Jedi, which is a completely different conversation, it turned everyone's expectations upside down. It created all this controversy. And what I think that they're asking JJ to do is, all right, here's what we need you to do from episode 9. We need it to be the box office blockbuster that beats Force Awakens, that you, which is the number one movie of all time. Okay? Mm-hmm. You've got to beat The Force Awakens. So it's got to be this financial juggernaut like we've never seen before. And I think it can. With
if
it. It's
the, they got to market it more than Solo.
Yeah, the marketing is going to be amazing. The timing of it's going to be amazing. It's the final story in the Skywalker saga. People are going to want to see how they pull off the Princess Leia stuff, because they're using her footage from The Force Awakens as the part of Episode 9. They're going to want to see all this stuff. And even the haters, I think, from The Last Jedi are going to want to come and see what to the theaters and see what happens with it. So I think it's going to be the box office blockbuster, say that three times fast, that they want. What they also have to do is it has to tie the story up. It cannot be where we're hearing this in the trailers and in the previews in the 3 weeks leading
up. This is not going to go the way you think.
Yeah. They told us to expect everything to be upside down. And those people that went into The Last Jedi, unspoiled and really believing them, that they were telling us, this isn't going to go the way you think. We got through this movie okay.
They were open-minded.
Yeah, but what people really do want is they want to see, how does this tie the Skywalker saga up? How does the Resistance become the good guys winning? Mm-hmm. How does this situation with Ben Solo, Rey, and Kylo resolve itself? What's going to happen with Princess Leia? What's going to happen with Rey? What's going to happen with Turbis the Porg?
Maybe not that one.
Yeah, I think so. I think the whole world wants to know.
Turbis the Porg is going to have a family and live happily ever after.
I hope so. But anyway, you see what I'm saying? I mean, yeah. Tie it all in. Mm. Finish this storyline, because I think they are desperate to move on from the Skywalkers. And they want to move on to something different. Yeah. They want to do that with Ryan. They want to do that with Benioff and Weiss. Mm-hmm. They want to do that with some of these anthology movies. And I think they're pulling back the anthology movies because they just want to finish off the Skywalker saga, put that to bed, and then start doing some of this Old Republic, some of this unknown regions, wild space stuff that I think that Ryan's trilogy is going to be. And then explore. I think that they want to go back and they want to do some Maul stuff. Why do you bring Maul into the storyline at Solo without having a purpose behind it?
Yeah.
I think that they want to do some stuff with Enfys Nest. I think they desperately want to do a Kenobi movie. But if they announce a Kenobi movie now, people are talking more about Kenobi and they're talking less about Clone Wars Season 7, The Mandalorian, Star Wars Resistance, and episode 9. And so what they've decided, we're not going to oversaturate the market right now. We're going to let things play out with episode 9, and then we'll start making some of those announcements, you know, getting closer to it. I do think we get those announcements, a couple of them, at Star Wars Celebration in April, and I think that we start moving forward. And that's the course correction that they're asking JJ to do. Finish the Skywalker saga in a really compelling, exciting way. Make it the blockbuster that it's supposed to be. Let us end Skywalker stories, and let's move on to the rest of Star Wars. What do you guys think about that?
I totally agree.
Awesome. Well, on that note, we will move on. Can you guys read your anything else's?
Yes, I can.
I'll figure it out.
I remember. Right.
Awesome, because we had a printing error. So, anything else you guys want to talk about?
Anything else?
So, there's a new Lego Star Wars show coming out.
Yeah.
On Saturday, November 10th. And it's called Lego Star Wars All-Stars. It's going to be basically about the all-stars of the series, like Lando, Han, Ahsoka, Anakin, Obi-Wan, Kylo, Rey, Luke, Padme, all those people. All the all-stars of the whole trilogy in every era. And it's just going to be talking about their different stories from different timelines. So.
Awesome. Very cool. Sam, you'll that?
Star Wars, Darth Vader, Dark Lord of the Sith, Volume 1.
The Omnibus is coming out Tuesday, baby.
Tuesday!
Yeah, we can get caught up on that storyline.
I've been wanting to catch up with that so much.
So when we go get to the Omnibus, Sammy, mm-hmm. I'm pretty sure they've already released the Omnibus, but I'm pretty sure this is the only hardcover version.
And well, we'll find out on Tuesday.
And then if it is the Volume 1, they already have the Volume 2 out.
So we'll see.
They can get that.
You can find out. All right. We should find out. And I'm sure some of our listeners already know, and they're tweeting us as they hear this, telling us about it, which we would appreciate that. Mark Hamill doesn't think the green milk from Star Wars The Last Jedi was that bad.
Like, bad taste?
People just didn't like that idea of him milking the teat. I used that word last week on accident. I'm using it this week on purpose. The teat of that, was it Thaline Siren or something?
Yeah, something like that.
They didn't like that, and they didn't like him drinking the milk, and they thought it was disgusting, and they thought it was like debasing and diminishing the character of Luke Skywalker.
I thought it was awesome.
Which I thought it was absolutely hilarious with it. But Mark Hamill thinks that people have overreacted with that. I think he's right. So
I would agree.
Okay. Well, let's see. Let's talk about our podcast poll of the week for next week, or this current week, I guess, is what that is. It's this week.
Yeah,
this week's poll, podcast poll. Real simple. Does Star Wars need a course correction? We're going to give you four different options. Yes, slightly. No, or it's complicated. And if you put it's complicated, we want you to comment on the tweet and let us know. That's pretty much it. So, take time to subscribe on whatever podcast service that you're using. We're trying to get some of the problems that we've had with that fixed. So please, happy beeps for that. Rate and review us, please, on iTunes. Please, 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 please. If you're listening to this and you haven't given us a rating and a review, please, please do that. It makes the world of difference to us. Share this episode with all of your Star Wars geek friends, Star Wars nerd friends. We are a family. We are a community. And I hope that family-friendly Star Wars content is something that you would be willing to share with others. So that's about it. Anything else you guys want to say?
May the Force be with you.
May the Force be with you.
May the Force be with you.
This party's over.
I like that Wookiee.
Don't get technical with me.
Droid, please.